HipHopsIs1987.com.
Hip Hop since 1987, we're live in Atlanta, and I'm with the lovely Miss Shanti Dawes. For those of you who don't know, she's a legendary music executive in this area. How are you feeling this evening?
I'm great, how are you?
I'm magnificent. Now, we're here as a celebration for L.A.Reid, and you used to work with L.A.Reid.
You worked
with him in projects with Outkast, Usher, and a lot of other artists. So tell us a little bit about that experience.
Oh my God, it was amazing. First of all, L.A.Reid is like the most creative person I know. And the one thing I respected about him is he really allowed us to do our jobs as well. You know, sometimes people hire you and they don't empower you to do your job, but he was the exact opposite. He empowered his staff. He allowed us to travel, to tour with the artists, to be a part of the decision making. And we really worked as a close-knit family at LaFace, and I think that was why we were able to launch the careers of so many artists that are still doing great today, whether it's Toni Braxton, Usher, Outkast, you know, TLC, Goodie Mob, the Toni Rich Project, you name it. I mean, it was a real blessing to be able to work with such a wonderful company. We kind of looked at ourselves as like the new Motown, if you will. And so we prided ourselves also on artist development, and that was the one thing about LA. He didn't believe in putting the music out and until putting the artists out on the road until they were ready. So our artists did rehearsals. They did vocal training. You know, we did all of that from an artist development standpoint. I think that's what's kind of missing in this day and age with some of the artists, but LA was like the absolute consummate professional.
Now, you were with Outkast from their earlier days. You were with them when they won their first Source Award back in the early 90s.
Yeah.
So seeing Outkast from then till now, what do you think of their growth as individuals and as a duo? And did you see this coming?
Well, the one thing I can say is, you know, we didn't have to like add a lot to the table when it came to Outkast. Like, they knew who they wanted to be. I saw the evolution of the fashion with them, you know, from Southern Playalistic to ATL and, you know, Aquemini and the Sankonia album. We allowed them to grow individually because they knew who they were. And so I'm not surprised at how they evolved as artists and individually either, because back then, you know, Andre was kind of the player, you know, Dre was the poet, and so they always had distinctive personalities, and so I think every year it just kind of started enhancing even more and more. But to see them touring 20 years later is a real blessing. You know, unfortunately we didn't get to see them tour on Speaker Box Love Below album, but it's all come full circle now, and they're still just as talented as they were when I first met them on that first single, Players Ball. And so Atlanta's in for a treat this weekend for those three concerts.
Now, you recently put out your own book. It's entitled The Hip Hop Professional. It's the woman's guideline to growing and climbing the ladder in the business world. Tell us a little bit on why you decided to write that book and some of the feedback you received.
So I really wanted to write that book to inspire young adults across the country and even the globe, just so that people know that there's still something to say for hard work, you know, being able to persevere, being professional in the industry. I tackle a lot of different, like, really good business principles and basic fundamental things that some of this young generation still needs to know. I think by us like tweeting and texting all the time, a little bit of our business and social skills gets lost in that. And so I want to bring everybody kind of back down to reality to let them know that the music industry is still a business. You have to treat it as such. And I also tackle a lot of gender issues. You know, being a woman working in entertainment, understanding the importance of equal pay and that sort of thing. So I think the book resonates with a lot of women that are working in the industry and helping them out as well. And I'm getting like photobombed right now by my good friend KP.
I also have to ask you, what advice would you give to young business women and men that are looking to get into the music business? Because longevity is something that we can definitely attach for your career. As I mentioned, you've been in the game with LaFace from the early 90s till now, and you're still a very predominant figure in the music world. So, you know, what would you teach, or what tips would you give to somebody about longevity in the music business?
One of the things I think that has worked for me from a longevity perspective is understanding the importance of relationships. We work in a relationship economy. You got to be able to pick up the phone and call those people. So now that I'm an entrepreneur and in business for myself, you know, if I didn't maintain those great relationships all these years, I wouldn't be able to get the support I'm getting for my book right now, or any of the other things that I'm doing with ATL Live on the Park and that sort of thing. So I had to make sure I didn't burn any bridges, keeping in touch with people, you know, out of sight, out of mind in this game. So you still have to be relevant, you know, and do those things that you need to do to keep those relationships alive. So don't burn bridges. That's very important. Even if somebody, you know, makes you mad and you yell, kick, and scream, you learn how to take the high road because you never know when you might need that person again.
I totally agree with that. Now, I also have to ask you about ATL in the Park, as you just gave light to. For those who don't live in the Atlanta area, it's a wonderful event that takes place outside in the park. You have different acts come and perform. You have different banquets and things like that. Explain to us a little bit more about that event and why you felt you needed to give that to Atlanta.
So ATL Live on the Park is a supper club style showcase. We do it once a month from April through November. When I lived in New York City in 2007 to 2009, I actually did an event called R&B Live. I brought R&B Live back, and then LA followed suit. Washington, D.C. started doing it. And so I was really just trying to have a platform for R&B artists to be able to perform in front of the music industry tastemakers, you know, the urban buying audience and that sort of thing. So just trying to keep that genre alive because I felt like R&B was kind of lacking in a lot of areas. So when I moved to Atlanta, I did the same. I just brought that concept of R&B Live down here, and we're in our fifth year now. We've had everybody. We had Miguel before he blew up. We've had our Kelly, Teddy Riley, Joe, Tank, Algebra, E. Robeson. I mean, you name it. We've had some wonderful people on that stage, so it's an honor to still be able to do that as well.
If people want to pick up your book or if they want to follow you via social media, how can they go about doing both?
You can get The Hip Hop Professional 2.0 on my website at www.thehiphopprofessional.com, and you can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at ShantiDas404.
Hip Hop since 1987, live in Atlanta, L.A. Reid celebration. It's about to be a crazy week in Atlanta. Outkast has their concert coming up, so be on the lookout for that. If you're in the Atlanta area, follow this young lady. She has a lot of great knowledge, a lot of great connects. Make sure you follow her and stay tuned to Hip Hop since 1987 for more news.